Welcome to the online service of Harborsite Baptist Church, a place of safety, rest, and resupply. We now join the morning service already in progress.
Now, you're in John chapter 20. I want to read verse number 19, and then we'll have a word of prayer. And I want to preach a message to you that that I have entitled, When Peace Seems Impossible. When Peace Seems Impossible. Verse 19 of John chapter 20 says, then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week. Okay, now this is resurrection day. Okay, after Jesus has been betrayed, tried, scourged, crucified, buried, he's raised from the dead. Okay, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and saith unto them, peace be unto you. Several hundred years before he was born, Isaiah declared that Jesus would be called the Prince of Peace, Isaiah 9:6. Of course, the angels proclaimed on his birthday, on the night that he was born, peace on earth. And he spoke often to his disciples about the peace that he could provide. Now, we look at things in our country. We look at things around the world. We know we're doing a study on Wednesday nights. And if you haven't been able to join with us, I hope you'll think about that. On Wednesday nights, we're continuing our study on fearlessly facing the future. And sometimes as we look around, maybe in your own life, we'll look at some things here this morning that I hope will be a help to you. But sometimes when circumstances come beyond our control, difficult times happen. The weather comes, right? And so on. And we have to make changes and so on, adjust our schedule or whatever it might be. Sometimes the peace that we can have seems very elusive. And we probably all know people, I know I certainly do, know people who they've been Christians for a long time. And they understand these principles and they've incorporated them into their lives on a regular basis every day, as a matter of fact, and they just seem to be very peaceful. No matter what goes on, no matter what happens, no matter what kind of news they get, no matter what they have to be doing in their life or any trouble that comes, they just seem to be at peace. And I want us to consider this morning, what should we do when peace seems impossible? We'll get to that here in just a little bit, but I want to look at a couple of things before we do that. And before we get into the message, let's have a word of prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we have come together. We ask your blessings upon all the families that are represented with us this morning. We thank you for the avenue that we have to stay connected when we can't meet together in person. We thank you, Lord, for those that make it possible, that have the technical ability to set these things up, and we ask your blessings upon them. I think especially of Dave Fraley right now. He is even monitoring right now, and he's responsible for the website and the Zoom and all of that, and it's such a blessing, Lord. Ask your blessings upon them and upon him and Kathy, and we ask that you would help us in these days just to understand that peace that we can have is possible every day of our lives. Every moment of our lives can be bathed with peace, but sometimes it just seems to be impossible. We look at circumstances, we focus on our lives, we focus on problems sometimes, we focus on our responsibilities. And sometimes that peace that passes all understanding that we can have from thee seems to go right out the window. And we pray that you would help us to understand these principles and incorporate that peace into our lives. We ask your blessings now in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, again, it says there, the same day at evening, verse 19 of John chapter 20, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and saith unto them, peace be unto you. I want to begin first by considering some some events, some things, some couple categories of things that would steal your peace. Okay. I want you to turn to Luke chapter 24. Turn to Luke chapter 24. And when we move away from this passage, I want you to keep your finger in Luke 24 because we're going to come back to it a little later in the message. But Luke 24, beginning in verse 13, it says, now this is also Resurrection Sunday, okay, the first day of the week and so on. It says in Luke 24, 13, it says, and behold, two of them went that same day to a village named Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 60 furlongs. Now, 60 furlongs, that's what that means, 60, 320s. furlongs is about 7.5 miles, okay? How long it would have taken them, it might have taken them, you know, average walking distance for the average human is about 3 miles an hour, so it would have taken them a little over 2 hours or so to get that distance. And that distance, if just to put it in context to give you an idea, is about from my home up to exit 6 on the interstate. Okay, it's about that far, roughly that far, 7.5 miles. They're walking, of course, and it says, and they talked in verse 14, Luke 24 says, and they talked together of all these things which had happened. And it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were holden that they should not know him. And he said unto them, what manner of communications are these that ye have one to another as you walk and are sad? Now he's listening to the conversation as he's going along with these two. He can tell from their demeanor, he can tell from the way they're talking that they're very, very sad. The peace has left them, okay? And the one of them, verse 18, says, whose name was Cleopas, answering said unto him, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem and hast not known the things which are come to pass there in these days? And he, Jesus, said unto them, what things? And they said unto him concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet, mighty indeed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and have crucified him. But we trusted that it had been he which would have redeemed Israel. And beside all this, today is the third day since these things were done. Yea, and certain women also of our company made us astonished, which were early at the sepulchre. And when they found not his body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels, which said that he was alive. And certain of them which were with us went to the sepulchre and found it even so as the women had said, but him they saw not. Now, what's the point? Why bring this passage to your attention? Well, one of the things that will steal your joy is problems. How many of us have ever had problems? Maybe you had problems today. We had a little bit of a problem. It's called frozen precipitation, okay? We had the problem of broadcasting the notice that we were not going to be in person today. It's a little thing, certainly, but if you focus on that, and it is a little thing, but sometimes you get focused on little things. How many of you ever heard this phrase? Maybe you've never done this before, of course. You make a mountain out of a molehill, right? You take a big thing, blow it up out of context, and it's the focus in the center of your life. And if it's a big problem, even though it may be a real problem, okay, it sometimes they are perceived, and sometimes we just blow these things out of proportion, right? And it steals our peace. Problems, and the kind of problems that we're talking about, certainly stole their peace. That's one of the reasons why they were sad as Jesus asked them this question. Why are you sad? What's going on? And they basically just tell him, what, you're a stranger in the area. You don't know these things. You're not familiar with what has been going on in Jerusalem. Well, let me tell you. And it has to do with the fact that this man that we followed, this man that we believed in, this man that we trusted in, and so on, he claims to be, and he was, if you notice, verse 19 says, which was a prophet. Okay. Now, granted, Cleopas is correct. Jesus is a prophet, prophet, priest, and king. Okay. The Bible tells us of that. But he was more than a prophet, wasn't he? He was the Prince of Peace. He was the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, right? He was the one, he is the one that is going to eventually, one of these days, deliver Israel. Now, when these disciples saw all of these problems, what happened to their peace? Their peace took a holiday, right? And the same is true in our day. I think about some of the folks that we mentioned here, some of the folks that are on our prayer list, okay? Many of them have physical needs, physical problems, and quite frankly, there is a variety of types of problems, seriousness of problems, and so on. I mean, we have folks that, you know, we have one man on our prayer list that has an inoperable brain tumor. We have other folks that have diseases for which there is no cure. And we have some folks that are awaiting doctor's appointments and different things like that. We're not trying to diminish or discount any of the problems, regardless of their magnitude. But what I want you to focus your attention on this morning is this. Problems often steal our peace. That's kind of common, normal, so to speak. But if you have problems today, understand this. Peace in the midst of the problem is still possible. But if you focus on that problem, it may seem impossible. Let's go on. I want to, let's go back to John. Hold your fingers in Luke 24 and go back to John chapter 20, okay? Go back to John 20. And notice this, second point here. Things that will steal your joy. Not only problems, okay? Problems are probably a big peace thief, so to speak, okay? But notice, if you will, John 20, we already read verse 19, but did you notice this? It says, then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, now notice what is going on, where these disciples are meeting. When the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled, what's the reason for it? It says, for fear of the Jews, okay? Why were they afraid of the Jews? Because the Jews had crucified Christ, right? Okay? And people certainly can, believe it or not, steal your peace, all right? Let's look a little further at some folks. Let's go to Acts chapter 8. Acts chapter 8. It says here, in verse number 1, it says, and Saul was consenting unto his death. Now, this is talking about Stephen. This is a continuation of, obviously, of chapter 7, where Stephen is stoned. Okay. He was the first martyr of the church. Okay. And you also know that the people that were responsible for that, they placed their coats at the feet of a man named Saul, okay? This same Saul, it is right here in verse number 1 of chapter 8. It says, Saul was consenting unto his death, and at that time, there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem, and they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation over him. As for Saul, here he is again. He made havoc of the church, entering into every house and haling men and women, committing them to prison, okay? Second point, problems will steal your peace. People sometimes do that too, right? How many times have you just been sitting there? Maybe you've been in your lazy boy Maybe you've just been on the couch or whatever it is. You've been minding your own business, not bothering anybody. And then all of a sudden, somebody comes into your living room and or you get a phone call or something like that. And all of a sudden, the peace goes out the window. Things are in a turmoil. And it's kind of like, what in the world just happened? Well, people will do that. Saul did that to the church. Their peace was gone, right? Let's look a little further in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 9 and verse 1 says, and Saul, okay, there he is again, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest and desired of him letters to Damascus, to the synagogues, that he, if he found any of this way, any Christians, okay, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. Okay? Here's a guy. We know the story. You've already read through it. But here's a guy that stole the peace of a whole bunch of people. And it's just one guy. Now, you think about people that have done that to you, maybe. Maybe it is that, I don't know, you got a relative that might be of a different political persuasion than you are. And every time you talk to them at a gathering or something like that, or you're getting text messages from them periodically, or maybe they're posting things on Facebook and so forth, and they're just antagonistic. It's like, oh, there they go again. Did you just see what so-and-so posted on Twitter or posted on Facebook, whatever it might be? And because you're related, you know them, or maybe you are the recipient of some of that stuff, your peace goes right out the window. Well, here, Paul wasn't just sending text messages, was he? He wasn't just buying up propaganda and different things like that. He was actually getting permission from the high priest to go and to find and to imprison Christians. And what was the purpose of it? What was he planning to do with the Christians? He wasn't going to allow them to live anymore. As a matter of fact, it says right there that he was breathing out threatenings and slaughter. Okay? You know what that means. Can you imagine being in the first century, being a Christian, being a follower of Jesus Christ, and living in the area and hearing that Saul is coming? What would that do for your peace? Not to mention the fact that the persecution that was under Saul caused them to flee. They were scattered abroad, okay? Now, there's a purpose behind that. Understand that. One of the reasons and one of the ways God used this persecution was to get the gospel out, okay? Before that, where were the disciples? They were in Jerusalem. What was the Great Commission before Jesus went back to heaven? What commission did he give the church? He gave the church to go into all the world, but they were staying in Jerusalem. Okay, persecution came, and what happened? They were scattered. Would that be a problem? Sure it would, especially if, I get news feeds and different things, and I've been the recipient of a free bug out bag, just pay for shipping and handling and so forth. There's a group of people in our country, and maybe around the world, I'm not sure. They call them preppers. They call themselves preppers, okay? And a lot of them have what they call a bug out bag. And a bug out bag, it could be maybe you need to leave your house in a hurry. Maybe you leave, as you're on your way home in your car, something happens to the car, you get stranded. Maybe it is, a whole host of different things can happen, a lot of different problems, okay? And the bug out bag is kind of like a survival thing. It's got maybe some water and protein bars and a flashlight and some extra batteries and some blankets and all kinds of different things you can put in one, okay? Can you imagine having to leave your home because this guy Saul is coming and not even being ready for that? And even if you were ready for that, even if you had your bags packed, you had it by the door so that anytime there's persecution, we can bug out of here. That's still a problem, isn't it? Where are you going to go? Do you have shelter somewhere? Do you have water somewhere? Do you have fire? Do you have food and all those kind of things? Those are all problems, aren't they? And they're all caused by one guy, right? People will do that. People will cause you problems. And when the problems are caused by people, what happens to your peace? Peace goes right out the window. I want you to notice something about this guy, Saul. You know, from further in the chapter, chapter 9 of the book of Acts, what happened to Saul? Well, he met the Lord on the road to Damascus. He was gloriously saved, okay? And he went from causing problems to having problems, all right? Now, I want you to turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Well, hold your finger in Acts as well, okay? Hold your finger in Luke 24, hold your finger in Acts chapter 9, and go to 2 Corinthians chapter 11, okay? 2 Corinthians chapter 11. And notice beginning in verse 23. Paul is talking. This is the second letter to the church in Corinth. And if you're familiar with 1 Corinthians, you know that, well, a theme of 1 Corinthians is problems. Okay, there it is again. All right, there were problems in this church. There was a bunch of baby Christians that didn't know how to act. They got carnal. They didn't understand what it meant to walk in the Spirit, to be filled with the Spirit, and so on. And there was problems. Every time you look at the book of Acts the book of 1 Corinthians, there's a problem. Problem with this, problem with that, problem with this, problem with that. Problems caused by people, okay? Now, Paul went from being one of those guys causing the problems to now having problems, even though he got saved. Okay, and don't misunderstand or miss this point either, and don't misunderstand what God is doing in your life. A lot of people think, if I get saved, all my problems are going to go away, right? No, that's not the case. That happens. Problems come no matter what. But one of the great joys of being a Christian is this. The biggest problem people have is where they're going to spend eternity. Right? And if I trust Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, what happens? Biggest problem I have being reconciled with God, having heaven in the future, right? And on my way there, that's the biggest problem it's over, okay? But still, we got to deal with people. We still live in the nasty now, the 21st century. We're still here. We still got to deal with difficult people, as we're learning on Wednesday nights, perilous times, hard to deal with, hard to bear times, and so forth. Now, notice what it says here in 2 Corinthians 11, verse 23. Let me start there. Paul says, "Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more." Now, notice some of the problems that Paul had to deal with. He says, in labors more abundant, okay? He's working harder than anybody else, okay? In stripes above measure, in prisons more frequent, in deaths oft, death threats, okay? Of the Jews, now notice this, of the Jews, five times received I 40 stripes, save one. How many stripes is that? It's 195 stripes. And not to mention the beatings that he mentions in verse 23. He goes on, he says, thrice was I beaten with rods. How many bruises and maybe broken bones did you think he got from that? Once was I stoned. He was stoned at Lystra and left for dead. Is that a problem? People brought that on him? Sure. Thrice was I beaten with rods, verse 25. Once was I stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. A night and a day I'd been in the deep and journeys often. Now notice this verse here. In perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils by mine own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the cities, in perils in the wilderness, perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. Besides those things, what are those things? They're all problems. And they're all brought on by what? By people. People will steal your peace because they bring problems into your life, right? He said, besides those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches, okay? Now, you notice what he said there. He said, besides those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. What is that? What kind of problem? What kind of thing is going on with Paul? It's not just outside caused by people, okay? Antagonistic people, people that are, you know, they think they're doing God a service just like he did, all right? But it's an inward thing too. You get focused on ministry. You get focused on trying to be an encouragement to somebody. You get focused on trying to be a help to someone. You get focused on trying to make an impact in their life for eternity. And whether anybody knows about it or not, there's a burden. We'll call it a problem because that's what we're talking about. Okay. How are you going to go about, you know, helping them and all of those kind of things? And Paul's got exterior problems, but he's got interior problems too. He's thinking about these things all the time because they were these people that all the churches, the care of all the churches. If I don't do it, who's gonna? If I don't tell them, who will? I got to go see them, okay? You're familiar with the fact that many of his letters, they're grouped in a group, okay? They're put together just for studies purposes. It's not mentioned this way in the Bible, but the prison epistles. You know, Paul goes to Rome and he gets arrested. Is that a problem? Sure it is. The care of the churches, is that a problem? Who's going to care for the churches? Sure it is. So what does he do? He gets busy writing. And we have Ephesians, we have Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, all called prison epistles. And they're brought on by people. Now, it might be because, you know, obviously because Paul cared for the churches. He cared for the souls of men, okay? One of the mentions in the book of Acts when he was arrested one time actually Peter, if I remember correctly, was imprisoned and chained and guarded by four quaternion of soldiers. Now, four quaternion, that's four groups of four is what that is. There would be two in the cell, one on each arm, so to speak, chained to Peter, and two outside the cell. Is that a problem? Sure it is. But guess what? Just as Peter is a captive audience, see, these soldiers are not going anywhere for 6 hours at a time. That was their shift. So every time they change guards, They get two chained to Peter, two outside the door. And what do you think Peter is doing during that time? Is he talking about the weather? Probably not. He's probably talking about their salvation, right? And sometimes when the problems come, we look at them. If we focus on the problem, we focus on the people causing the problem, but we don't look at the fact that the reason we have the problem is so we can come in contact with the people that have a bigger problem, not knowing where they're going to heaven or not. And I want you to notice something about Acts chapter 9. I told you to hold your finger there and go to Acts chapter 9. This is, of course, the chapter that includes the conversion of Saul of Tarsus, who became Paul the Apostle. Okay, Paul of Tarsus. All right. Notice Acts chapter 9 and verse number 10. Okay, Paul is on his way to Damascus. He's got these letters from the high priest to go and, you know, maybe even have a list of Christians, okay, to go to Damascus and get these people, round them up, bring them to Jerusalem, throw them in jail, thinking to execute them because they're Christians, okay? He's on his way to Damascus. The Lord shows up. He's blinded for 3 days. And verse number 9 says, and there was a certain disciple, a follower of Jesus, at Damascus named Ananias. And to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias. And he said, behold, I am here, Lord. And the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he prayeth. And he hath seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming, putting his hand on him that he might receive his sight. And Ananias answered, Lord, now notice, there's a problem caused by a person. Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard by many of this man how much evil he hath done to thy saints at Jerusalem. And here, Damascus, he hath authority from the chief priest to bind all that call on thy name. Okay, wait a minute, Lord. Hang on just a second. Are you sure you want me to go see this guy? That looks like a really big problem to me. Notice what Jesus says, though. The Lord said, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me, to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. Notice verse 16, please. He says, and I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. We just read about those in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. All those perils, all those problems, all those beatings, all those that stoning and shipwrecks and all of that, all of these problems, Jesus showed Paul shortly after he got converted. You know what's really amazing to me? I was thinking about this just this morning. Paul knew he would face trouble, problems, but willingly fulfilled God's will anyway. Isn't that amazing? How did that happen? How can you look? How, if you were told when you got saved, from the day you get saved to the day you die or the Lord comes back, there's going to be all these difficulties, what would you do? What would that do for your peace? Is it possible to have that kind of peace, even knowing, you know, Paul wrote to Timothy, yea, and all they that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Okay, maybe you haven't, I never have, suffered persecution like we're talking about in the first century church. There are people in this world, even in the 21st century, who are suffering persecution. I got something recently from a group that sends me emails and so forth about North Korean Christians. North Korea is an atheist state. It's a communist state. If you don't worship the Kim family and the divine ruler who's there now, Kim Jong-un, guess what? No questions asked, you go to prison. You may go to Mongolia somewhere in a gulag until the day you die. That happens today. China, same thing. Any place that is a predominantly Muslim country, there are Christians being persecuted, absolutely. Here in America, we haven't gotten that. Praise the Lord for that. I'm thankful for that. It could come a time when that comes to our country. Problems come. Mark it down. It's gonna happen. Don't feel like the Lone Ranger, okay? You have problems, I have problems, everybody's got problems, but they can't necessarily steal your peace if you understand what peace is all about. But problems can steal it, people can steal it, misperceptions can steal your peace. Go back to Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. We already read a good part of this passage from verse 13 to 24. And when Jesus is asking Cleopas about what kind of things, you know, took place in Jerusalem, why are you sad, the problems that you have, the things that have come into your life and so on. And he again says, Cleopas again says, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, okay? How the chief priests and rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and have crucified him. Now notice, but we trusted that it had been he which would have redeemed Israel. Okay, that's a misconception. Jesus is going to do that, but when he came first, how was he going to redeem Israel? How is he going to redeem us? How is he going to redeem mankind? Make it possible for us to have our sins forgiven. How was it going to happen? Well, they just mentioned it. He was going to be crucified. Now he's coming again, right? And he will set up his earthly kingdom on the throne of David in the city of Jerusalem, and there will be a 1,000-year reign called the millennium of Christ. That is going to happen. Some of his disciples, including Cleopas, thought that, well, you know, the Messiah is going to throw off the shackles of Rome, that he's going to get rid of all of our enemies and so on, and there's going to be peace in our land. That's eventually going to happen. But it wasn't going to happen the way they thought it was going to happen at this particular point. They had some misconceptions. What is a misconception? Well, a misconception is a wrong understanding or interpretation. When they knew, they heard, maybe they, you know, read it in the Old Testament, the Messiah would come, they automatically thought that he's going to rule and reign Israel. He's going to throw off the enemies. He's going to throw out the enemies, and throw off the shackles of Rome. That's not what he came to do the first time. So they were misunderstood. And misconceptions, if you misunderstand something, misinterpret something, what happens? What happens to your peace? Maybe you get frustrated because you didn't. You know, how many times have you ever had somebody say, maybe they get upset with you and you ask them, what happened? And they say, well, you said thus and such and so, whatnot, and this and that and the other. And you go, no, I didn't. Well, yes, you did. You said thus and such and so and so. No, I didn't. You misunderstood what I said. I would have never said that. And people misunderstand. Oh, well, I'm sorry. I didn't. I misunderstood what you said. Yes, you did. Did I hear you right? Did you say this? No, I didn't. I said this. And misconceptions can cause problems, can't they? And when those problems come because we've misunderstood, what happens to the peace? But notice, let's go a little further. Jesus says to, in verse 25, he says, "Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets had spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." Look over at verse 44. He says to his disciples, he says, and he said unto them, "These are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. Then opened he their understanding that they might understand the scriptures, and said unto them, Thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem, and ye are witnesses of these things." You see what he did there? They misunderstood what he was saying, what the scripture said about Jesus, about the Messiah, about the Christ. And he started with the scripture because that misconception can be cleared up when you go back to the Word of God. And what did he do? It says there again in verse number 45, "Then opened he their understanding that they might understand the scriptures." See, misconceptions, when we don't understand properly, causes problems, doesn't it? People misunderstand what we say, why we're doing something, and so forth. And the peace goes out the window. So let's ask this question. Since misperceptions can steal your peace, people just don't understand. They don't, why are you doing that? Why'd you say that? I thought you said, man, I really thought I misunderstood. I thought you said this. I've had people mention to me before, I'll not get into it. But it's a misunderstanding. A misunderstanding. What's a prescription? Is it possible? Is peace possible? Even when there are problems, even when there are people that are antagonistic toward you, people that don't understand, misconceptions. Is it possible to have peace? Well, one of the first things you have to do, Luke 24, notice what verse 27 says. How do you get back to the peace? What's a prescription for stolen peace? How do you fix it? Well, a good place to start, the first place you ought to start, is found in verse 27. Luke 24, 27 says, "And beginning at Moses and all the prophets." What does that phrase mean? At that time, they only had the Old Testament. Now we have the New Testament, the completed Bible, Genesis to Revelation, okay? "Beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." What's a prescription? If your peace is gone, whether it be because of problems, because of people, because of misunderstanding or misinterpretation of what's come into your life or what somebody says or did, what God's doing in your life, what do? You start with the scripture. That's the best place to go, right? But what happens, though? Too often what happens when people lose their peace because something took it, what do? Well, oftentimes a lack of peace and a lack of hope, a lack of peace engenders a lack of hope, which causes depression and so on and so forth, and you feel tired and you get down and you all this and all that, and you get anxious and whatnot. What do a lot of people do? They go to the doctor, and I just don't feel well. And the doctor asks, just like the doctor asked me back a few months ago when I went for my wellness check, are you feeling a little depressed? Do you feel okay? Do you sleep all right? Are you anxious about anything? Are you afraid about something? What are they asking those questions for? Are they really genuinely concerned? Maybe they are, but what's one of the things that they might just do? They'll give you a script. You can go down to Walmart or CVS or Rite Aid or Walgreens or some other pharmacy, and you can get a pill. Is that going to take away the cause of the lack of peace? No. It just numbs you up, doesn't it? Okay, is that the answer to the problem? No, we're just dealing with maybe a symptom, okay? But notice what he did. He was concerned about the fact that they had no peace. These problems came, they misunderstood. What does he do? He doesn't berate them. He doesn't, you know, call them names or anything like that. What does he do? He just simply takes them to the scripture. Right? Now, he did say some pretty hard things to them. He called them fools and slow of heart to believe. Aren't we kind of the same way? When we allow problems and people and misunderstanding, misconceptions to steal our peace? Sure we are. But we start with scripture. Go there. Go to the Bible first. If you're lacking peace, if you think you're in a situation, you're in a circumstance where peace seems impossible, get into the Word of God. Do that. How about this? Let's go to Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16. Here's another way that we can gain our peace, that stolen peace from people, problems, misperceptions. Notice what it says in verse number 9. Mark 16:9 says, now when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven devils, and she went and told them that had been with him as they mourned and wept. Okay. Mary Magdalene's the first person that saw Jesus after his resurrection, okay? She goes to tell the disciples, all right? Now notice what it says here. And they, when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, what are the last two words of Mark 16:11? Believe not. They didn't believe her, okay? They said, you are crazy. As a matter of fact, we know that you used to be possessed of devils and were wondering if maybe you haven't had more trouble like that right now. But notice it goes a little further. After that, he appeared in another form unto two of them as they walked and went into the country. We read about that in Luke 24 on the road to Emmaus, Cleopas, and quite possibly his wife. Okay. And they went and told it unto the residue, okay? They took off. They left for Jerusalem, 7.5 miles away, round trip 15 miles, okay? They took off after they understood that Jesus was, in fact, alive. And what did they do? They beat feet for Jerusalem, and they came and bust into where the disciples were holed up for fear of the Jews, okay? And what did they say? They said, we've seen him. He is alive. As a matter of fact, we really didn't notice and really didn't think it was him until he broke bread. You can read it in Luke 24, but let's go a little further. Notice what verse 13 says. And they went and told it to the residue, neither believed they them, okay? Mary Magdalene, they didn't believe her. Now we've got a couple. Cleopas and most probably his wife, her name was Mary, by the way. She was with Mary, the mother of Jesus, at the cross. Anyway, that's just a little aside, okay? They take off and they say, hey, look, we have seen Jesus. neither believed they them. Verse 14 says, afterward, he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat. And notice what it says here. And upbraided them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. The point I'm trying to make here is this. Are you aware of the fact that there are a lot of Christian people in this world who have gone through problems that are greater than the problems you face right now, as great as your problems are, who still retain their peace? You know that? Have you ever talked to them? Have you ever just gotten some encouragement from them? That's really what we ought to be doing, right? We shouldn't be hard-hearted toward them. We shouldn't be the source of, in a matter of speaking, persecution toward them, because we don't understand. We have a misperception of what happened to them. Second Corinthians chapter 1, if you want to turn there real quickly, let me get there. Peace seems impossible sometimes when problems come, people cause problems, misperceptions cause problems you don't understand. But there's a prescription: get back in the Word and also study the experience of others. Just like Mary, she was a good testimony, believe it or not. Cleopas and this other, his most probably, again, his wife, okay, they were good testimonies. They should have been listened to. But notice 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3 says, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. Isn't that a wonderful thing? When problems come, what do we want? We want comfort, even in the face of them, even as we're going through them, right? Just like the little child that's sick, or maybe the little child falls down and scrapes their knee or something like that, right? And they run to mom. What do they want? They want a little Band-Aid and a little kiss on the forehead, you know? Kiss it, make it better. They want some comfort, okay? So do we, all right? Where do we get that comfort from? We can get it from family sometimes, but sometimes people don't understand. People can't help you as much as maybe you'd like them to. But there is one person that can help you all the time, every time. It says here, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. Notice verse number 4 says, who comforteth us in all our tribulation, that we, now here's the reason. He comforts us in problems. He restores that peace when our peace seems impossible. People, problems, misperceptions, bring it. It happens all the time. But God gives that back to us for a purpose. That we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. Maybe it is that you've gone through something. You've gone through a problem. You had somebody, you know, cause a problem. Somebody misunderstood. You know how that is. You know that heartache. And you come in contact with somebody else who's going through the same thing, because you've gotten your peace back, because you understand these things. You've gone to the Lord. He's given you comfort. He's given you that peace that only He can give. And you're able to give them a personal testimony. And that's what we're talking about. Study the experience of other people. Read about not only the scriptures, but maybe you know somebody. Maybe you just lost somebody that was dear to you. Maybe it is that you had a problem and you know somebody that's come through it. I know my father-in-law has, you know, he's had a heart attack and he's got two stents. He's got a brother and a sister that have gone through the same thing. You know what he did shortly after he got home? He called them and talked to them. Tell me about what kind of medication you're on. Tell me about how long it took you to recover, how long it took you to feel, you know, feel up to doing anything, and so on and so forth. Tell me what your doctor told you about this particular thing. Okay. And it was a benefit to him. I had the opportunity years ago. There's a lady visiting in our church. And I don't know if it was in the illustration of the message that I was preaching or not, but she came to understand that I had had a dislocation fracture of my right hip. She said, "Would you mind calling my son?" He was 19 years old at the time. And I said, "Sure, what for?" And she said, "Well, he was in an accident and had a dislocation fracture of his left hip." I said, "Whoa, well, okay. How long ago did that happen?" She said, "Just a couple of days ago." And I said, "So he's still in traction, right?" She said, "Yes, he is." I said, "He's in the hospital, obviously." "Okay, yes, he is. He's feeling a little down." I said, "Sure, I don't mind calling him." I called him up a couple of days later and I said, introduced myself to him. And I said, "Your mom tells me you're having a hard time. She was visiting in our church this weekend and she asked me to call you. Tell me what's going on." He said, "Well, I had an accident." And I said, "Okay, tell me about your accident." And he says, "Well, I broke my hip." I said, "It was a dislocation fracture." And he said, "Yes." And I said, "I know exactly how you feel." And he on the phone said, "No, you don't. You can't understand how I feel." And I said, "Oh, yes, I can." 8th day of December, 1992, which was a few years prior to that, I said, "I had the same thing happen to my right hip." He said, "Oh, Pastor," he said, "I'm sorry. Tell me about it." And I was able, as best I could, from clear across the country, to encourage that young man and give him some hope, give him some peace. Shouldn't we be doing that for one another? Sure, we should. Sometimes peace seems impossible. Problems will take it. People will take it. Misperceptions. But there is a remedy if you'll take it. Paul knew personally about the peace of God, which passes all understanding. He wrote about it in Philippians chapter 4. And the Holy Spirit, you got to understand this. Don't miss this point. The Holy Spirit is the one that produces it. That love, joy, peace, and other fruits of the Spirit are possible for us. It's not impossible that we look at circumstances and go into them with peace of heart, peace of mind, because it all centers around one big thing. That's the trust that we put in the Lord. Now, I'm not trying to discount it. I'm not trying to cause, you some consternation or anything like that. But I know when problems have come in my life, yes, I know what it means when the peace just goes. But you got to refocus. You got to get back into the scripture. You got to go find somebody that you can, that maybe has been comforted in the way you're looking to get comfort. And of course, understand this, God is the God of all comfort. Is he not? He's the one that brings the peace. We stay close to him, beloved, no matter what comes, no matter what source steals our peace, we can still have that peace that passes all understanding. Peace may seem impossible in these days, but it's not. It's not impossible, which means what? It is possible to us. Now you get back in the Word of God. If you're having trouble, get in God's Word. Search out some folks that could help you and be an encouragement. If you have had a problem, you've come through it, look for somebody to be an encouragement to. Look for somebody to say, "Hey, look, I know you're struggling with this. Hey, can I just give you a personal experience, a personal testimony on how God helped me through it?" Because that's what we're supposed to do, right? We're supposed to comfort others by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted. Brings us that peace that we need. that peace that passes all understanding is possible to all of us. We just need to take those steps to make sure that we don't let people steal it. We don't let our problems take it from us. We don't misunderstand what God is trying to do in our lives. And we trust him for his honor, his glory, and certainly for our benefit. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we've had to look in your word. And sometimes, Lord, the peace just doesn't seem to be there. And we pray you'd forgive us, especially if it's attached to a lack of trust. If we don't trust you, Lord, well, if we've trusted you for our eternal destination, why is it so hard sometimes to trust you with something temporal? Only you can answer that question. We pray you'd forgive us for our unbelief and our hardness of heart in not believing the testimony of others who have come through difficulties and sometimes even worse and greater circumstances and problems than we have had. Help us to stay in your word. Help us to go to you, climb up in your lap when we are hurting, when we need comfort, when we need peace. Dry our tears, Lord. Kiss us on the forehead. Tell us it's going to be okay. Mend those hurts. Mend those wounds. Help us to do the same for others, that we might be testimonies of that peace that passes all understanding, that we might allow the Holy Spirit to produce the love, the joy, the peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith in us, that others might see it and be drawn to Christ, regardless of the problems we face. We ask your blessings now in Jesus' name. Amen.